you saw the Super Bowl this year, of course Sarah Helen and I saw it. We actually did. We watched it for the commercials this year. And if you did, you already know who our special guest is today, but we're going to say some more about her anyway. I want to say thank you to Reverend Marion, who reached out to Estella Pyfrom for us and went and met with her. And she is going to share with us a little more about Estella and Willie and prepare us for what they have to share. So Reverend Marion, will you come on up?
So I'm the pastor who actually watched the game. Go Patriots! All right. Yesterday when I had the opportunity, Lee and I are teaching discipleship class, and I don't need this mic.
But anyway, part of the characteristics of Jesus when you learn in this class is an overwhelming sense of purpose, some traits of Jesus. Radical inclusivity, non-materialistic, a sense of humility and service. Those are the traits of Jesus. These are also the traits of our preacher today, Estella Pyfrom. You're going to learn from a non-materialistic when she tells you what she does with her retirement savings for her husband. You are going to know that she has such a sense of purpose, that it is about her passion for the underprivileged children in our community and around the world. That with her persistence, her perseverance, despite challenges, that she presses on, you know. And she got this CNN Hero Award when I was able to visit her in her home. Actually, she has a big picture, like floor to ceiling. You know, she goes, what am I going to do with this? She said, my kids want me to hang it somewhere, you know, and it's life size. But she, you know, it is fitting because she makes a life size contribution to the community. You know, the quote for the CNN here, ordinary people doing extraordinary things around the world. And that's what she awards. She showed me the award amongst many awards on her table there. This ordinary people do things around the world, and she does things in our community. She's living with passion and purpose in our community. You know, there was a saying, Mahatma Gandhi said, you must be the change that you want to see in the world. And she lives that. She breathes that. She embodies that quote. You know, here our vision at MCC, PB, is we are a joy-filled, justice-centered community. You know, our values, community, that we care for our brothers and sisters, our neighbors, we mentioned in the opening, right? And so this lifelong teacher as Jesus was, is going to be able to talk to us. And, you know, she already has a community with her four children, Jean and Juan and Karen, who was with us this morning, and Mia, and her 14 grandchildren. And her partner in life, her husband, Willie, for 56 years. So this project as that she's called, this brilliant project of hers, where she lets her light shine everywhere she goes, that with her partner, Willie. And so he's actually going to be a part of this service by actually playing on his trumpet. He's a music teacher, and he will play a little music as she preaches. But please give a warm MCCPB welcome to Estella Pyfrom.
Thank you. would never be the same. This little light of mine, I'm not going to let anyone blow it out. I am so happy to be here. And I'd like to say thank you to Reverend Marion Kavanaugh and Dr. Brown, who fought it up with me to make sure that I was going to be here. So I'd like to thank you for that. I'd like to also say, to God be the glory for the things that He has done for me and my family. And I shared this morning with the group that when I first came in today, because this is my first time being here, that it got to be really an emotional thing, because I guess one of the reasons why this kind of thing is touching to me is because every single week someone say to me, why are you doing that? You should be on the beach. When I've never been a beach person, why do I wait till I get almost 80 to go to the beach? Interesting enough, all of the news media from different points interview my children at different times, and they ask the question, what would you like for your mother to be doing? And of course, it's interesting because I didn't have these conversations with my kids. I find out through the third party. And one of my sons said, what I'd rather for her to be on the patio, in the swing, sipping tea, but I don't drink tea that much. So it really turns out to be whatever she wants to do, let her do this. Now, I'd like to tell you a quick story that I didn't tell the first group. And of course, the people who were here first have an advantage over the other one, I mean the second time, because you get to hear some things the other group didn't hear. One of the reasons why I was encouraged to get into doing what I'm doing is, during our years, we worked very, very, very hard, my husband and I, and we didn't have very much money. Of course, you know, school teachers don't make very much money. So we invested in properties, and you know. One day I received a call from my youngest son, and he said, Mom, we had a meeting, and we want to talk to you about it. So I said, okay. He said, well, we decided, because they never like to talk to us about dying and death and anything like that. They think we're going to live forever. Well, they said, what we think will make sense is sell your big house. We had worked hard and bought a big house. And then take the equity in your big house and buy you a smaller house and live there forever and travel and do all the things that you wanted to do. Don't try to leave anything for us, and we hope when you finally die that you have not one penny left. Well, it made sense to sell the house because there were no kids there. And while we were raising them, we tried to carry them different places. So my husband said, well, to be honest with you, there's nothing I want to do. Estella, do whatever you want to do, just don't bother me. If you need me, call me, I'm here, but don't bother me. Okay. But anyway, we decided to sell the big house, and here we are. I wanted to do what I'm doing. Now, I grew up in the projects, and one thing that we learned in the projects is really understand that it takes a village to raise a child, okay? We grew up in a village. We didn't have very much money, but we certainly knew how to take care of each other. Our parents worked long hours. They felt pretty sure that we were going to be safe home, because if there was one person in that neighborhood, we were going to know they were there, and they were going to know, so they looked out for each other. So what we did after my husband and I talked, sharing that passion, wanting to give back to the communities. And as long as I can get the sanction from him to say, okay, do what you want to do, then I really start thinking about what I wanted to do when I retired. After 48 years, I retired the first time. I got talked into going back to work, so I went back to work 2 years. And then I started thinking, hey, I'm approaching 80 real fast. And I have some things that I want to do. What am I going to do when I finally do retire? So I put together this plan where I had to know exactly what I was going to do from start to finish. And as I grew up, my dad and my mother, neither of them finished elementary school, but they did believe in education. So they encouraged all of us. I had 5 sisters. And they encouraged us, number one, they taught us how to do everything, how to take care of ourselves, which is great. At age of 8, I could cook an entire meal. And I know not to burn the beans or the rice because I couldn't replace them. So I had to learn everything very well. But during my younger years, I learned all of these things, how to care for each other, how to braid hair, how to clean up, how to wash, how to cook, and all of these things that turned out to be very valuable during our later years. So as I worked through the 50 years in the school district, I was guilty of carrying kids home, teaching them the same thing that I learned how to do. And 35 and 40 and 50 years later, I meet kids that I haven't seen in that many years in the store or somewhere in another state that says, hello, Ms. Pipham, do you remember when? So I forget about all of these things until they remind me. And I'm saying that to say, when you do things from the heart and don't have a real personal motive for doing that, sometimes you forget them. But God has a way of reminding you and bringing you back and say, there is a purpose for being here. And I want to say too that this morning when I was sitting here thinking for a minute, I was reminded that August, 2 years ago, we were in a serious accident. A year before then, my mother was injured again. He died 4 times, paralyzed. But he's back here again today, and I was happy that he was able to blow his horn a little bit because this was the first time that he did this publicly since he had that accident. Spinal surgery, and the doctor said, you know, we don't know at your age, whether you're going to be able to overcome this. But we went through the surgery. We went through 1 full year of rehabilitating him. And now he's up and about. And we always said there's a purpose for us being here, and to God be the glory. So we see him today. People when we need them. Mm-hmm. We are a lot older than Patrick. Our youngest son is older than Patrick. But what can 85-year-old people do us with the bus? They can't drive. So Patrick steps in, and sometimes he won't let me sit in my own bus seat. So I want to say publicly thank to Patrick. Thank you so much, Patrick, because he's always been there for us. Okay, thank you again. And all of the right things happen at the right time. I'm diverse a little bit because people know a lot about me because they can go Google it, but I just feel like I have to say this in the 10 minutes. The reason we know that we are on the right path and we have a purpose for here, look where we are today. We didn't know these people, so there's a whole new circle of friends who believe in the same mission that we believe in. And another thing, I said, to God be the glory, you know, because what I'm asked a lot is, why are you doing this? These people, you're not going to even get a thank you from this. You're not going to even get this. And but the kids that I serve have nothing to give but love. I don't care if they don't say thank you. Because we have a mission. And I want to say to you that we are proud to say we serve a lot of kids between the ages of 3 and a half all the way up to adults and senior citizens. And the kids have nothing to give but love, but we know we're making a difference. And it doesn't matter whether they say thank you or not. We're going to keep on keeping on and doing the things we are doing.
Amen. Amen.
I want to quickly tell you a little bit about what we do in the breeding bus that we have out there. We are able to serve kids on that bus, as I said, as young as age 3 and a half, get them involved with technology. But what we do, that has to have a purpose. We want to make sure that these kids are getting ready for preschool, they're ready for kindergarten, they're ready for first grade and all the way up. We can also do GED prep, CNA prep, almost anything that someone needs us to do, we can go to these remote areas and we can deliver that service. And at the end of the summer, we're proud to say that we have served more than 73,000 children. And I'm not talking about them. That hasn't been easy. But first of all, it took some thinking and some good planning to be able to take all the money that you have worked hard and saved over the years and invested in a project. You know, you have to step out on faith with God being at your side and say failure is not an option and make it work. And this is the one thing that my parents instilled in us, that if you work at something, you can't fail. You may have deterrence. You may have all kinds of challenges, but it's only temporary unless you make them permanent. And there was no such thing as making a failure permanent. So we didn't even claim that. We knew that the minute I decided that I was going to do that business, I knew it was going to be successful because I was going to make it successful. But the whole idea behind this is not what kind of recognition it could bring to me or to my family, but the good of what I can do for the communities. And just about, I'll say about 5 months ago, I couldn't understand why all of the commotion. What's the big deal? It's just the bus, the computers, and I just do this and I do that. And I was talking to one of the CNN producers, and we were talking about something, and I said, well, what's the big deal? She said, Stella, when you make one of the top 10 finalists on CNN from across the world, that is a big deal. I just couldn't see it because, number one, I'm not in it for the recognition. And the quick story behind the recognition is Patrick had been working with me as a volunteer, and he did say to me one day, what if somebody nominated you for CNN? I said, I would say, no way. But he had already done it at that time. And then when I did receive the call, after hours and hours on the phone, I said, no way, I don't talk to the media. I don't like them. They're so negative. I hate them. NBC's CNN. And it was between this, I won't go through that story, but I sent CNN away. I thought I sent them away. Back. NBC came in and they didn't ask me. They told me that we're going to write the story, so they scheduled it and promised me that if you don't like what we come up with, we won't publish it. And in the meantime, CNN come back, had already scheduled it, and here we are. They sent the producers out, and they start writing the story. And from that point on until now, it has been nonstop. Now, I'm not very good at making excuses because they don't work. The excuses don't get the job done. But I tried to ward off all of the media because I didn't like them, number one. And my reason was, I'm not very good at this. I don't know what to say. And the thing that I really got me started, and I couldn't talk out of it, when one of the CNN producers said to me, well, Estella, you say you're not good at that, you're very bad at it, but I'm very good with people. So between the two of us, you and I, we should make a good team. Give me a try. Okay. So to make a long story short, we've been celebrated across the world. But I am appreciative of all the things that people do and celebrate me for. That's not what I'm doing this for. You know, I keep my eyes on my target. I realized too that it's different out here where I am because I work against the odds. I'm almost a 79-year-old black female, which is against the odds. And they tell me if you're over 45, you run from technology. So when I saw that on the shirt today, that it's different here. It is very different here. I also want to say that I realize that it's not where you come from, but where you are headed. We didn't have very much when we started. And there may not be anyone in here who is old enough to relate way back when I was a girl. But when I was a kid, we couldn't sit on the front of the bus. We had to stand in the back, and if, even if there were seats on the front, we couldn't sit. We had to go to the back if you were black, and we had to stand right that way. But I'm proud to say that today, not only can I sit on the bus, I can sit wherever I want on the bus because I own the bus. Very many toys, so we had to take old socks and make a ball so we could play with it. And other things we found around the house, I was curious, I would take them loose, put them back together, and sometimes I would get a beating. You're over that. But now I said, as I grew older, my kids called me the gadget lady. So I used to do interesting projects at school because I was gadget focused. And then I got this crazy idea about this big bus gadget. And the bus is a big gadget with a mission on a movement, so it works. So sometimes you get these crazy ideas, if you put some thought in them, they will work. My time is running out. Let's see the video. Okay.
My name is Estella Meifer, and I am the founder of Estella's Red Bus. We travel to low-income communities where many of the families do not have computers.
It's always good to go back and reread the information again, okay?
I was a teacher for 50 years, and I started thinking before I retired, what can I do? So I had an idea. We left our retirement, we sold property that we had, and I created this bus. When kids get on this bus, they're able to learn about the world and connect with the world with Microsoft technology. I can empower them to make their lives better. My vision is to have one bus in every city in the United States, and I'm working on that. Addressing our calling, and we are doing what God has in store for us to do. Thank you so very much for having me here.